Welcome back to Flashpoint and this conversation over the 8th District and who should represent that district in Congress in Michigan, Elissa Slotkin or the current Congressman Mike Bishop. I wanted to give you both a chance to respond to ads that have been running against you. You cannot get through a commercial break right now without one of or both of your ads running. Ms. Slotkin, this is we're going to start with you. This is an ad that started out on, it's a radio ad. This one started running very early in the campaign. It speaks to something that the Congressman mentioned earlier. Here's just a portion of that ad.
Elissa Slotkin was recruited by Nancy Pelosi and sent here from Washington. Slotkin doesn't own a home in Michigan, and her only voting record? For herself, just a few days ago in the Michigan primary. Elissa Slotkin even admitted that she doesn't know our area.
I do not know the outlines of the district.
You couldn't quite hear the quote. I do not know the outline of the district was the portion of audio that you used. What's your response to what you heard?
Sure. So this is a pretty classic attack that my opponent has made, particularly about Nancy Pelosi. It's a pretty common thing that folks are using across the country. I have made very clear publicly that I would not support Nancy Pelosi as our next speaker. I couldn't be more clear about that. And he says that Nancy Pelosi recruited me to run for this race. Mike Bishop recruited me to run for this race the minute he voted to just completely obliterate protections for people with pre-existing conditions. That is personal to me. My mother had a pre-existing condition. She couldn't afford health care for years. And it was his personal act in that, watching him on the White House lawn, that recruited me into this race.
You've set up the next portion here for him to respond to pretty well. This is an ad that I know you've seen a lot. It's been running in very heavy rotation. And we'll get Mike Bishop's response to a portion, not the full 60 seconds, but a portion of that ad.
So when I saw Congressman Bishop smiling at the White House after voting to gut protections for pre-existing conditions, something inside me broke. I'm running for Congress, and I approve this message because, Mr. Bishop, that's dereliction of duty, and it's a fireable offense.
There's been a lot of talk about your position. In fact, Republicans all over the country are having to defend their votes on health care. What's your thought to that claim in the ad?
My wife has a pre-existing condition. She was born with juvenile rheumatoid arthritis. It is first and foremost on my mind. Health care is not only important to families, it's essential. So when I voted for that bill, there is no way I would have ever voted for it if it didn't include protections for people with pre-existing conditions in it. All you have to do is read the bill. It's part of the job in Washington, D.C. I'll give you an example. I'll give you the exact position in the bill, and I can put this up on my website. It specifically indicates that we are prohibited from not authorizing health care coverage for people with pre-existing conditions. And also, let me just say something else. When it comes to this whole issue about Nancy Pelosi, she has broken every record. She is the biggest special interest in the state of Michigan right now. She's funneled millions of dollars into the state. And even though she says she doesn't get supported by Nancy Pelosi, she's out in California. Ms. Slotkin is out in California raising money in lavish campaign events. And I just can't believe that she'll go to Washington, D.C. and not be bought and sold.
I don't want to set that aside, but I'd like to stay with this issue of pre-existing conditions.
Sure.
For a moment, and both of your plans for health care.
Sure. So let's be really clear. I mean, this is why people can't stand politicians, because they say one thing and they do another. So he's right. He can quote his bill that says that you can't prohibit someone with a pre-existing condition from getting care. That doesn't mean they can afford it. That's exactly the position my mother was in.
They can't afford it now.
Sir, that's exactly the position my mother was in when she lost her job in Oakland County in 2002. She lost her insurance, and because she had cancer many years before, she could not afford health care. So let's make clear that people need to know the truth. They can't stand when people say one thing and do another. That's not making it affordable.
To his point that health care has gotten so expensive now,
yes,
that a lot of people, whether they've got pre-existing conditions or not, can't afford it.
Sure.
You're not a supporter, as we've been hearing many Democrats talk about during this cycle, you're not a supporter of single-payer universal care.
I am not. I'm not, because I don't understand how you pay for it. I don't believe in Canadian-style health care. I believe that people deserve access to health care they could afford, and how we do that is our generation's problem to solve. I believe that there should be a buy-in to Medicare for anyone at any age, so that young, healthy people can buy an affordable plan, so that employers don't have to constrain the size of their business because they can't afford to pay everyone's health insurance, I think it's a great opportunity.
Congressman, to her point, that you can include a prohibition against removing care for a pre-existing condition if you don't cap the cost, what's the difference?
Well, here's the problem. You know, we have many things in place that we voted for in that bill, including a pool to help defer the cost of people with pre-existing conditions. That was part of it. There were many different implementations along the way to protect people with pre-existing conditions. What Ms. Slotkin is talking about as a solution is a buy-in to Medicare, which is already teetering on the edge of insolvency. If you do what she's suggesting, which is a complete takeover, a government takeover, it's doubling down on a system that already doesn't work. If you do that, you're going to bankrupt Medicare, you're going to jack up rates, and you're going to push people off the system that currently have elderly people and people who can least afford it.
And how do we how do we fix the mess that we have? I really don't know very many Americans who love their health care.
As I have advocated for in the past and continue to advocate, we need to go back to a patient-centered system where our individuals, our families, our businesses can pick their own health care, not a government-run template that's forced upon them. It doesn't
can't
pay for it.
It works in many other places in the world.
We have 330 million people. It's bankrupting our country and bankrupting our families. It's got
to
be changed.
We're going to run short on time. I want to get to a couple of other topics. I'd like to ask you both if you believe that man has played a part in our changing climate, in global warming, and if he has or hasn't, what do we do about it?
Sure.
We've taken the United States out of the Paris Accords. What do we do now?
Sure. So at the Pentagon, I helped conduct one of the first studies that the U.S. military ever did on the effects of climate change on the U.S. military. Our bases, our ranges, the melting in the Arctic so that the Russians can put strategic weapons there. We just took it as a planning factor, right? The military's job is to plan for all contingencies. So yes, I believe that climate change is happening because we can see it. Our military believes it's happening.
Have we had a role in it?
Sure. Yes, I think, listen, I don't, I'm someone who believes in science and believes in facts, and I think you just have to talk to the farmers in our district, talk to them about their concerns about climate change.
Should we be in the Paris Accord?
I believe so, yes.
Congressman Bishop.
I do believe that there is a clear evidence of a change in our climate in this world. Whether or not it's man-made, who knows? I believe in science as well, but we live in a cyclical world, a cyclical earth that's gone through many different forms of different weather patterns and ice
not
ages.
All of which have been survivable.
Not
for
all
of them
were survivable. But they weren't caused by human beings. And so I think the more important question is pollution and keeping things safe. And while she's talking about national issues, international issues, I want to talk about Michigan. What we've done for the environment right here in Michigan to protect our Great Lakes, to ensure that the water is pure, that our invasive species are under control. That's what we're working on, bipartisan, working together to ensure our Great Lakes are safe from predators.
Can I just step in? I know it's Halloween season, but you just can't put on a mask and become an environmentalist because you're in a tough election cycle, Mike. Okay, your voting record for 21 years has done nothing to protect our water, to protect our air. You've made it easier to go oil and gas drilling in our Great Lakes, and you've made it harder to prosecute the companies that are moving gas and oil in our pipelines. So you can't just switch because you're in a tough cycle and because it polls well for you.
In the immortal words of John McCain, you either don't know the truth or you're not telling the truth. And that's the bottom line. I have done so much in my career to address Great Lakes issues. My whole family spends time in the Great Lakes. That's been our heritage in this state. I live here. And future generations depend on what we do. And I'll tell you this, before she was against it, she was for Line 5 across the Straits of Mackinac. I have done everything in my power to ensure that we get a solution to that problem. It is an impending nightmare, catastrophic event. And I have done everything I can. I like the solution that they came up with to build a tunnel underneath, away from the water. But we have got to continue to put our money where our mouth is and not just spit rhetoric back.
I can only give you both about 30 seconds on this last question, I'm afraid, and it's probably bigger than 30 seconds. But given the vitriol that we have right now, that I can see a little bit of at this table, how do we bring America back together?
Yeah. I think the important thing is having people care about getting something done instead of just saluting their party. And I think that takes people who have experience being public servants, who are ready to work harder and to think bigger, It's a different generation, and I'm proud to be part of a number of veterans and service candidates running across the country, people who've served both Democrats and Republicans and have lived that life.
And your thoughts on that same topic?
I'm a part of a group called, it's a bipartisan group called the Problem Solvers in the House. It's made up of 24 Republicans and 24 Democrats. It's kind of like Noah's Ark. You each come in at one time. And these 24 and 48 members, I mean, meet together regularly, and we talk about issues that are important to our country, and we try to incubate and push out good ideas for our leadership to grab onto, everything from immigration to national security to whatever you can think of that's pressing in this country. That's how it begins. Among 48, we'll spread that civility out to our 435 members.
I so appreciate you both being here. Thanks very much.
Thank you very
much. Two more joint appearances coming up before Election Day. We'll wrap things up for Flashpoint right after this.
Thank you.